Very well. We start the 5 o'clock session. It's an honor to have Toft from University of Utrecht here. He is the winner of Nobel Prize for proof of renormalizability for the weak interaction, electroweak interaction, I should say, which proved to be the missing component of the standard model, which we are now all using to describe the interactions of particles these days. Professor Toft is going to speak on the importance of black holes in our attempts to understand elementary particles. Professor Toft, please start.
Thank you very much. It is a honor and pleasure for me to be in your country, even though I'm only virtually present. I have been invited before, but once it was the climate in Iran that was standing in the way, and later were for political reasons. But now it's Corona, which forces me to only be virtually present. Okay. Okay, let me begin with the subject of my talk today. It's not directly about the electroweak force, but about the one very essential major stumbling block ahead of us, the difficulty of including gravity in our theories of elementary particles. And one possible way to learn better how to do that, how to understand the relation between gravity and quantum mechanics, is to study black holes. The first part of my talk will be about black holes in general, and then later I'll focus on what they have to say about elementary particles. Can you show me the next slide, please? So I don't see the next slide yet on the screen, but it's slide number two. This is slide number three that you're showing.
I'm here. Yeah.
The previous slide.
Oh.
This is slide too far.
I'm on page two, the gravitational force.
Oh, page one has disappeared apparently. Well, anyway, on page one, it was showing that gravity is a universal force. It acts on all objects with mass. So the sun attracts the earth attracts the moon, the earth also attracts people, and they all attract each other. The force is always proportional to masses, and that means that the force always has the same sign. It is always attractive. I'm now going to the slide that you have already in front here. This enabled Albert Einstein in 1915 to formulate a new fundamental theory for gravity, which is called general relativity. General relativity was an extension of special relativity that he had invented almost 10 years earlier to describe what happens when objects obtain a very high speed, a speed comparable to the speed of light. This wonderful theory that he produced now included gravity in special relativity, and as such it became general relativity. And his great insight was that it is the curvature of space and time itself that is responsible for the gravitational force. I won't be using many equations in this talk. You just see one equation which I'm not going to explain in detail. It is the central equation that Einstein derives from his considerations of general relativity, which tells you that the curvature of space and time, the r with a little symbol below them, the r here and minus one half r with another symbol below it, that describes curvature of space and time, and that curvature is directly generated by the presence of masses. The T here stands for the mass distribution in that same universe. G is neutrons constant, and C to the fourth, well, C there is the velocity of light. And so the velocity of light comes in, the gravitational force comes in. And so this theory combines very large velocities with the gravitational force. Next slide, please. Shortly after Einstein formulated this theory, only a few months later, can you try to show the slide, which is my list, is slide number 4.
Yes. Schwarzschild.
On slide number 4, we see a portrait of Karl Schwarzschild. Karl Schwarzschild was a well-known astronomer in those days. And when Einstein had formulated his theory, he only formulated how to calculate very small deviations from Newtonian gravity. So planets don't exactly move in elliptical orbits. They move a little bit differently. Light doesn't go straight when it goes past a very heavy body, but it's very slightly deflected. But Schwarzschild said, wait a minute, Mr. Einstein, if I have your equations, are you showing slide number 4, please? Because for me, slide number 4, that I still don't see here on the screen. Slide number 4 shows Karl Schwarzschild and a picture. He solved the equations while actually being in the German army at the Russian front. And gunfire was flying over his head, but he found inspiration to do some physics equations in those circumstances. And he solved Einstein's equations exactly for a special case. The exact solution had perfect spherical symmetry. And Schwarzschild realized that if a system is perfectly spherically symmetric, then the equations simplify a lot. So even those difficult equations that Einstein had written down, he could solve them. And he found a solution. So now I'm already on slide number 5. Okay, you're just showing the previous slide of the pictures of Schwarzschild. Now please go to the next slide, where
I have changed.
This is the slide I want. Schwarzschild, unfortunately, died a few months after he wrote that paper. And so, of a horrible disease, probably he contacted that disease while being in the army, I don't know. But anyway, the equation he wrote down is also written here. Again, I'm not going to explain the details of this equation. I'm sure some of people in my audience know the equation very well. For others, it's totally new. I can't explain it in detail. But it shows the structure of space-time as a function of the distance r. The letter r that you see in these equations shows the distance from the origin. And as a function of the distance, the space and time are curved. That is what this equation tells them. And Einstein hadn't realized that such an expression could be written down. But the expression shows something very disturbing. It already disturbed Schwarzschild himself. We said, wait a minute, if r approaches the value 2gm over c squared, that you see on the lowest line of this transparency, if r approaches that value, you can see that the things between brackets in this equation, and in the first term it's in the denominator, those things go to zero. And that means that there's something very odd happening with the curvature of space-time and, in fact, with the gravitational force itself. R equals 2gm over c squared, since you divide over the light velocity c squared, it's a very small distance. So it's very close to the center of the system he's looking at. Schwarzschild emphasized that he was calculating a field of a point mass. Point mass means that literally you assume all the mass to be in the center of your configuration. And then you calculate what happens. So you don't explicitly see the effect of the mass in this equation, because the mass is just at r equals zero. At least that is what Schwarzschild thought But then he said, wait a minute, there's something important going wrong if I approaches 2gm over c squared. So that is probably where the point mass is lying. I'll have to shift the meaning of the symbol r. R was just a number, and you could just say, okay, I subtract from that 2gm over c squared, and then the zero value you get, that's where the point mass is sitting. So Schwarzschild tried to repair something that he saw as a deficit in his answer, but there wasn't exactly a solution to the equations. There's nothing you could do about the solution apart from rewriting it. That is what Schwarzschild did. Unfortunately, he died only a few months later, so he did not witness the terrible confusion that his equation brought about. Can you go to the next slide, please? So at r going to 2gm, not only the gravitational potential entirely vanishes, the gravitational field goes exactly to zero or to infinity, but there's also something strange happening with space and time itself. Schwarzschild realized that at that point, time seems to be standing still. Well, we already knew from Einstein that there's a redshift. If you go very deep into a gravitational field, clocks go slower. But now, in this ideal solution of the equations, the clock not only goes slower, it stands still completely at this distance from the center. So you're not yet at the center, and already your clock is standing still. So Einstein, so Schwarzschild nor Einstein understood what's going on out there at that moment. And our present understanding is much better. What they were describing is a black hole. It's now called a black hole. And a black hole has very special and very exotic properties. Next slide, please. So at r going to 2gm over c squared, time stands still. And so you can not only ask what happens at that point, but you can also ask the question, wait a minute, r can become less than 2gm over c squared. What is happening there? This seems to be even stranger. And in the beginning of this field, this research, people could not understand what was happening at r less than 2gm over r squared. Next slide, please. Well, the next slide shows planet Earth itself. And on planet Earth, we have also a problem with describing how the surface of the Earth looks. How do you draw a map on planet Earth? To draw that map, you need coordinates. And for that, we use longitude and latitude. So can you show slide number 8, please? So on slide number 8, you see that there's something odd happening with the coordinate frame you use at the North Pole. At the North Pole, all the lines that indicate longitude, so across the Atlantic Ocean, you see here, you have all these vertical moving lines. Those are lines indicating longitude. Exactly, here's the screen. At that, the expression of the longitude becomes meaningless at the North Pole. So you can ask, maybe you can try to already put the next slide on. At the next slide, so you can ask what happens at the North Pole. Well, what happens at the North Pole is just like what happens when a polar bear walks on the North Pole. Imagine a polar bear walking around there. What would the polar bear notice when all these lines come together? He was sitting exactly on the North Pole. The answer, of course, is the polar bear would notice nothing at all. He wouldn't know about those lines, and he couldn't care about it. As long as he can find food, it's fine with him. And so the same thing we can say about black holes. The point r equals 2gm over c squared, that point is like the North Pole on planet Earth. The coordinates that we use to describe time become meaningless because they all come together. So that is why we now call that point a horizon, just like from ships at a close distance from the North Pole. When they look at the North Pole, they have to look over the horizon of the Earth. And so there's a horizon there. And now, today, we understand exactly what goes on at that horizon. But in the early days, it was quite mysterious. Can you go to the next slide, slide number 10? Yes, so somewhat later, more solutions of the same nature were found, because the black hole is not the only thing that can happen. We can, by the way, understand how a black hole could be formed if a star with lots of matter inside collapses under its own weight. A star collapsing under its own weight decreases in size, and then the gravitational force increases, so the collapse will go faster and faster. Eventually, the star will go through its own horizon to go inside. But and that's when this black hole solution is realized. But soon after Schwarzschild wrote down the solution, two other people, Reisner and Nordström, found also in 1916 another solution, which is if you put electric charge in this black hole. Imagine that the particles out of which the star was formed actually happen to be electrically charged, all with the same charge, which don't neutralize each other. Then the black hole would become a charged black hole. And that could also be described in terms of a rigorous solution. That, by the way, was technically not very difficult. Much more difficult was what happened only 50 years later, when a smart mathematician named Kerr, Roy Kerr, in 1963, discovered yet another solution. And that solution was not spherically symmetric, and therefore it was mathematically much, much more difficult to obtain. And what was even more difficult was that if you now again add electric charge, what will happen then? The solution that Kerr and later Kerr Newman found was a solution where the black hole is spinning across its along its own axis. I'm not yet at the next slide. Just continue to the leave the previous slide. You're too far now. This is also too far. Go one step back. I'm still here. So thank you. This is for me slide number 10. This is the slide I want. There were other solutions, and the new solution that Kerr and Kerr Newman found are solutions where the black hole is rotating. Therefore, it has no spherical symmetry anymore. It has angular momentum. Both angular momentum and electric charge in physics are absolutely conserved quantities. So if a star collapses with angular momentum, the black hole it makes also will have that same angular momentum. There's nothing you can do about it. And that was a new solution, very difficult. I don't even bother you with the equation that came out of that. It was a complicated equation, but again, it was exact. No approximation made anywhere. And the other amazing thing is that mathematicians like Penrose and Hawking found later was that these are the only stable solutions of this nature. So these are the only black holes that can exist in nature. They can be rotating. They can, in principle, be electrically charged as well. The black holes that later will be found in the universe, we don't know much about their electric charge. Probably their charge is not very big. But we do know about their rotation. And rotating black holes indeed occur a lot in the astronomical world. Now please go to the next slide. Yes. No, stop. Go back to the previous. Go back one more. That's the slide I want. In that slide, I just indicate that black holes are favorite toys for science fiction authors. They love to think about what happens if you have a spaceship and you see a large black hole, like the black holes that astronomers nowadays detect in their telescopes and in their machines. If you go with a spaceship inside that telescope, that black hole, you'll see very strange things going on around you. You are crossing the North Pole of the Earth, but now this time a polar situation in the coordinates of space and time itself. It's a lovely subject for science fiction, unfortunately very, very unrealistic. In reality, the forces there are so enormously gigantic, they are so huge, that no human traveler would survive such a journey. In fact, you can estimate that the forces that would be exerted on your feet and on your body and on your head would all be slightly different, so much so that you would be torn apart completely in a fraction of a second. That would happen for a black hole as heavy as the Earth or the Sun, but only for very, very large black holes, those forces could be reasonable, but such black holes are so tremendously large that, unlike it was described in this Interstellar, this famous science fiction movie called Interstellar, where scientists did have a say, but the scientists didn't remark that's totally impossible. You need black holes thousands of times heavier than the Sun to survive such a journey in principle, although even those you would in practice not survive at all. There would be too much matter around such tremendously heavy black holes. But according to the Interstellar movie, which was just on our TV again a few weeks ago, this black hole was situated near the planet Saturn. But if a black hole with 1,000 times as heavy, as much mass as the Sun, would be standing near Saturn, the Sun would no longer be there, and neither would we, neither would be Saturn, of course. So this is totally impossible. The gravitational field of a black hole would contract things so much. If you take a black hole with the mass of the Earth, the radius where all these strange things happen would only be 9 millimeters. So think of the entire Earth squeezed to a little marble as small as this, of just a few millimeters. And for the Sun is much heavier than the Earth. So for the Sun, the black hole would be larger. It would be about 3 kilometers, the diameter. So the radius would be 3 kilometers. Diameter would be twice that, 6 kilometers. For the Earth, it's about this big. For the Sun, it's 6 kilometers. Still very small compared to what the Sun is today. It's more than 100,000 kilometers in size. So these are extremes, so extreme that the real adventures of humans near black holes are totally impossible. Could you show the next slide, please? What physicists have accomplished in discover that, or to confirm a prediction of Einstein's theory, which is that the gravitational force can also generate radiation. And the radiation would be very similar to the radiation of Maxwell waves. So I saw that you produced some efforts. We can produce a picture of a moving wave. If you can do the same thing with Maxwell's wave as you did with the gravitational wave. So Maxwell's waves arise when you have electromagnetic forces. And if you let those fields propagate, they can only propagate with the speed of light. And then you get the famous radio waves that had been predicted by Maxwell and Hertz and so on. And now that is a solution of Maxwell's equation of electromagnetism. Einstein's equation gave a very similar solution. If you can show the previous, this wave, then that is a gravitational wave. There are some subtle differences between the gravitational waves and the Maxwell waves in their symmetry pattern. The Maxwell waves, when you rotate them 90 degrees, you interchange electric and magnetic fields. But you have to rotate them 180 degrees around the axis along which the wave is moving to get back the same pattern. In the gravitational wave, you have to rotate 90 degrees to get back the same pattern. And this has to do with the spin of the graviton. The graviton is a quantum particle that could generate the gravitational field. And that quantum particle has spin 2, whereas the photon has spin 1. So the equations are all different and all interesting. Those gravitational waves move with the same velocity as Maxwell's wave do, but in their details, they are very different. It is extremely difficult to detect gravitational waves, but this has been done successfully at first by the American gravitational wave detectors called Virgo, called LIGO, but soon also accomplished by a European detector called Virgo in Italy. So these two marvelous detectors could detect the very, very weak gravitational waves emitted by black holes from an enormous distance of us. Black holes can undergo very violent interactions. They can collide and merge. Those would be generating gigantically strong gravitational fields. So you show the next slide, please. If they circle around them, they will, no, just the previous. Now you're going on too far. That here's the slide I want. In this slide, you see what happens if black holes orbit around each other very rapidly. They'll emit gravitational waves in accordance with their position in their orbit. So the gravitational waves will spiral out. This is an extremely exaggerated picture. In reality, those waves are extremely weak and difficult to draw. But those waves have recently been detected and give a very interesting boost to our astronomical knowledge of very heavy black hole-like objects. On the next slide, you see a picture of black holes here, of which you can look up. I don't know how accessible it is in your country to look up YouTube and find simulations of black holes merging. What you would see is actually very complicated, because light is affected by gravitational field as well. So you wouldn't see the black holes where they actually are, but you would see the light rays emitted with them. So you would see the black holes like through a curved mirror. So you would see them very distorted when they merge, but they would emit electromagnetic waves, just like gravitational waves. Let me now return, that's that picture, yes, to the picture that black holes are very weird. So the question was, what is this horizon and how do I understand what's going on? And what happens when I go beyond that horizon? And the answer given by the equations is a very interesting answer. The answer is that that if you have a universe which is slightly curved, it meets another universe which is also slightly curved, and then our universe will come into contact with another universe. So now show that same next picture. Here you are. This is the change that happens. Instead of continuing at the origin, you see a hole emerging, and that hole connects our universe to another universe. This is the famous wormhole that people talk about, and this is what the scientists of SciTrek, of Interstellar, wanted people to do: run through this black hole and its wormhole and enter into this other universe, as if this would be possible. But as I explained, black holes are far too violent to make this possible in reality. But you can dream about it, and most importantly, you can ask about the physics of this wormhole. What is it? How do I understand that these things connect to space and time and matter as we know them? And how does it connect to particle physics? Next slide, please. Because now I'm going to begin with what's only the second half of my talk, if I have enough time. And that is that there are actually two categories of black holes. The first category are the very large black holes. They have masses at least 3 times heavier or so than the sun. So that's category one. You see large black holes. There's Schwarzschild radius is at least 10 kilometers, if not larger. But they can rise all the way to 10 billion kilometers, or the masses over 10 to the 9 solar masses. So these are tremendous monsters which only live at the centers of galaxies. And there people found black holes that seem to be huge in size, varying from millions of solar masses to billions of solar masses. But these black holes are all very similar. You see, the point about Einstein's equations and what Schwarzschild also noticed is that there's a free parameter. The one thing that the equations don't tell you is how heavy is your black hole and how large it is. What the solution tells you is that the size of the black hole is directly related to the mass, but that size can be anything. It can be very large, it can be very small. The mass will then also be large or small accordingly. So there is another category of black holes, the very, very tiny ones. And theoretical physicists can now imagine black holes to be as small as 10 to the minus 33 centimeters or bigger. You have to understand, if you're not well familiar with physics, then you might not appreciate how small that number 10 to the minus 33 centimeters is. It is a very small number. Even for particle physicists, this number is ridiculously small. The mass of the black hole is small. It's something like 20 micrograms, a small grain of sugar. But you have to imagine that mass is very large if you want to squeeze it into such a tiny volume as 10 to the minus 99 cubic centimeters. If you want to squeeze mass into that small volume, you can imagine this is still a very, very strange object. It's very heavy for this size. It's heavier than most elementary particles, much heavier, but it is smaller than any elementary particles. That's because a strange factor of C squared emerging everywhere. But also Newton's constant doesn't help because it's so very small. Now, we are interested in such small black holes, not so much because we really believe that they occur in the universe, probably not, or not directly. They might, however, occur as quantum fluctuations, because here comes the important message, and that is that if you would imagine black holes to be as small as this, then quantum mechanics would start to play a major role in their behavior. When black holes are large, quantum effects are totally negligible. They're so small that they don't occur in the equations. You can't even compute what quantum mechanics does to such large black holes. It's too small. But when black holes become as small as this, quantum effects become larger and larger, because you see the masses become smaller, so the wavelengths will become larger, but the size becomes smaller, so the wavelength associated to these masses will reach the size at this spot. This is called the Planck scale, because as soon as Max Planck discovered his first ideas about quantum mechanics, he realized that now we have three-dimensionless numbers, the velocity of light, Planck's constant, the Newton's constant, and Planck's constant. Now you have three constants. You can fix three units, three units of mass, units of time, and units of length, and they all come together at this in this domain where you see the very tiny black holes. In these things, you have to combine Einstein's theory with quantum mechanics. Now, if you think that quantum mechanics is a difficult and crazy theory, I'm totally with you, because yes, it is a crazy theory, and yes, it is difficult to formulate. If you think, and actually, many people say quantum mechanics is even crazier than you think. If you think you understand quantum mechanics, think again. That's what people like Feynman and Pauli and Schrödinger and all these people said. Quantum mechanics is a very strange theory. Now, on the other side, black holes are also very strange objects. So you can imagine that how strange and complicated it is. Next slide, please. If you try to combine quantum mechanics with black holes altogether, this is too far. Go back. Far again. And back again. Back. This is the slide. No. The one, the nearly empty slide I was looking at. No, go. Well, one, yeah, this slide. This is just my cry out how crazy quantum mechanics is when you try to combine that with black hole physics. Then everything becomes really absurd. So now you can go to the next picture. The guy who really made a difference here was the guy at the center of this picture. Those two figures standing behind him are Einstein and Newton. But Einstein and Newton were dead long before Stephen Hawking was born. But this is an episode in Star Trek where Stephen played a modest role in Star Trek. And of course, he loved science fiction and he loved speculations about black hole. So that's so in science fiction movies, you can do everything with time that you like. So you can bring Einstein and Newton back to life and have them chat and play poker together with Stephen Hawking. But this same Stephen Hawking, next slide, please. Um, I'll have to get my slide. Sorry, again, going one too far. Go back, please. This is it. This is the slide. In this slide, I explain what Hawking's problem was. He gave himself an assignment. He asked, how do elementary particles of black holes of any size behave when they are on their on that horizon? This was a very sensible question, but also a very difficult one, because as I said, quantum mechanics is difficult, black holes are difficult, you combine them, you get something impossible. So people thought you'll never succeed in answering this question. Well, indeed, in the beginning, when he did his research, as he told us later, in the beginning, he didn't understand what's coming out of his equations, because he wanted to describe what particles do, but what he got out didn't make any sense. So then he said, okay, if I can't describe what particles do near a black hole, can I describe a black hole without any particles? So take that horizon of a black hole, assume there are no particles there. How do I describe that? What happens to a detector which wants to detect particles? And again, he got something nonsense out of that, because he discovered he couldn't get all the particles out. Whenever he described his equations, he said there are particles going in the detector. No matter how many particles I take out of the black hole, there are always some left behind. That was very difficult to understand. That was the problem, again, with the polar bear sitting on the North Pole. He encountered that problem, but then raised to high power because he was doing quantum mechanics. But finally, he figured out what happens. It's very simple. The black hole is always has particles around in near its horizon, no matter what you do, and some of those particles will escape. So what he derived was that black holes actually emit particles. And not only that, what he found was that the emitted particles, the emitted particles behave in a way that you can understand. They actually behave as if the black hole is glowing. The black hole has a certain temperature. And that is on the slide which comes after this one. Just one slide. Here you are. He could compute the temperature of the black hole. This is something new. The idea that black holes might have a temperature was already raised earlier by a good physicist by the name of Jacob Bekenstein. Bekenstein said that the laws of the black hole horizon look very much like the laws of thermodynamics, as if the black hole has a temperature. And the reason why he said that was that the total surface area of the horizon seems to only increase. You can't make it decrease, just like the way you can't make entropy decrease. Total entropy of a thermodynamic system always increases. It never goes down. So that's a law of thermodynamics. He found the same law applying to the horizon of a black hole. And if two black holes merge, you also see the same law that the two horizons just add up. And but a bigger sign could not compute the temperature. He just philosophized black holes must have a temperature, but he couldn't compute how big it is. Hawking put the constants of nature in place. There's a h bar c to the third divided by 8 pi, Newton's constant and Boltzmann's constant. They're all in there. And with this value, he could understand how the polar bear on the horizon would perceive particles as related to how a distant observer would see particles. The polar bear, by the way, would see a perfect vacuum, would see no particles at all. But he would see that when he put detectors close together, you'll see vacuum fluctuations. But for the distant observer who looks at something else, those fluctuations become real, and the distant observer will actually see particles coming out. A lovely result. The mathematical physics of that is very nice. And the conclusion was very clear. Black holes emit particles. Next slide, please. But Hawking for a moment thought this is unreal, this can't be real physics. But then he realized that the black hole emits particles as if it glows at a certain temperature. And he found, no, let me go back for a moment. But if you say this, then the black hole must actually lose particles. It emits particles. And it emits particles like a light bulb emits photons. And when he realized that, You could also calculate, now go to the next slide. So the next slide just shows the argument that you see this is the horizon now of a black hole in space and time. Space and time looks a bit different than in ordinary space, like on the surface of the horizon. But now you see that if you put a polar bear there, the polar bear sees vacuum fluctuations there, but no particles. But the distant observer does see particles. And the reason is that the distant observer cannot see what happens beyond the horizon. That was the main argument. So next slide, please. Where do Hawking particles come from? And the problem was, what's wrong with that polar bear? And the answer is his work very differently. Next slide. So because black holes emit particles, that makes them in a way more human, because many forms of matter emit photons. Just at any temperature, objects like stars and planets emit light, but also heavy nuclei emit particles when they are radioactive. So it's a very normal property of matter to emit particles. So now a black hole looks more like an ordinary elementary particle. And for particle physicists such as myself, this is great news. Black holes are like elementary particles. Let's try to understand them. Maybe then we can understand quantum gravity. So go to the next picture, please. Actually, however, well, what I had on the previous slide, but I can say that now. What I had on the previous slide, there was a problem with this. And the problem was that the black hole, even though Hawking applied quantum mechanics to a black hole, he didn't get the right quantum equations for the black hole entire. He did not get a Schrödinger equation for a black hole. In fact, there was a deep problem standing in a way, and that was the black hole was a wormhole to another universe. What happens at the other universe could not be cast into a Schrödinger equation. So there's something very wrong about it. Particle physicists like Leni Susskind and myself disagreed with Hawking, who said, okay, then the black hole has a wormhole in it. And Susskind and I said together, that can't be right. Susskind wrote a book about his discussions with Stephen Hawking called The Black Hole War. I'm against that title because it's not a war. We were in discussion, and we were having strong, heavy discussions about this. But it were discussions, but we were all friends, of course, and we were not having a war with each other. I myself came with my own answer, which is again very different from answers that other people gave. And now go to the next slide, please. You have seen this already before. The black hole connects universe one and universe two. And now go to the next slide, you see again this wormhole. But that universe two, according to my own equations, isn't another universe, not at all. It is the same as our own universe. It is in fact the other side of the black hole. You just cut the black hole in two halves, then you go through the horizon, you go to the other half of the black hole. That makes a black hole much better amenable to the application of Schrödinger's equation. Now the theories, the equations all come together. However, it gave you a big difficulty with space and time. Yes, so now in this new slide, you see that space and time are going to get a new twist in them. A twist on top and above what black holes already do for space-time. Black holes do strange things in space-time, but when you say that, well, what I just said, that the black hole connects two halves of itself together, then it means that if you go through the horizon, you can't go there physically because you will die, as I explained, but you can send an atom into the horizon and see what happens. That atom, no, go back. Previous slide, please. Yes. That slide, the atom will cross this little circle in the beginning. That's where the horizon is. And it will not go to the other universe, the other side. It will go back to the other side, to the same black hole. And that makes mathematically perfect sense. Physically, it is bizarre. And physically, that means that things as heavy as a black hole do something with space and time that's nearly inconceivable. They let you go through a wormhole to the other side, where normally you'd have to go around a particle to go to the other side. Now you can go right through it. And now I can go to the next picture. That means space and time itself form a form a kind of vacuole. Where you see the crosses here, you can go through, you can enter this from the side, go through the cross, and then the inside of the black hole is not even space-time. No, you'll be carried instantly from this cross to the opposite cross at the other side, and then you continue your journey. Same thing if you go into the black hole at the circle, then you'll instantly be sent to the other side and continue your journey. I would call this a vacuole. It's not even vacuum. It is less than vacuum. There's not even space-time in there. So my response to the difficulties people have with black holes, the inside of the horizon, I say there is no inside. There only is the other side of the black hole itself. Mathematically, it makes much more sense, and even physically, it makes much more sense than what people were saying previously about black holes. And now go to the next slide. Now we can fantasize and say, okay, if this is what the black hole says about space-time, what does the black hole say about vacuum fluctuations? Vacuum fluctuations may tell us that there will be many more of those vacuoles. So now go to the next picture, just the middle one, yes. Now you see there could be much more vacuoles, and space and time could start to behave like foam. This is actually also what other physicists who approach a problem from a very different angle called string theory also sometimes believe, that space and time tends to take the shape of foam. The surface of the foam is really two-dimensional rather than three or more dimensional. So space and time really are two-dimensional structures which contain very crazy vacuoles. All space-time is more than empty. The particles can only happen in the spaces in between these vacuoles. How to do this, however, is a total mystery. So yes, one can speculate about this, but no, this time I don't have the physical equations. Yes, so the only thing I have is these crazy, this picture of the vacuoles. I don't know how much sense the picture takes. So mind you, this is really science fiction, but this is the kind of science fiction I like to do with black holes. And I like to dream on how this can be brought into a sensible set of equations for particles, equations which will shine a very different kind of light on the problem we have of reconciling quantum mechanics with gravity. But that is our distant goal. We can speculate about black holes. Eventually, black holes will tell us something about what space and time are doing when you encounter such things as black holes, such things as quantum gravity, and you want to get all the equations in place. We haven't succeeded. So this last picture I showed you could be dead wrong, but maybe the very last picture could be, or the picture beyond this could be good. This is my last slide, just showing that in Iran, people think of everything, including vacuoles of space-time. At the ceiling of one of your mosques, which I grabbed from the internet, I see a picture very much like this one. This is my last slide. So please go back to the last slide where I announced that my talk is over. And I thank you very much. If people have questions, I'll be very happy to answer any question that you have about physics in general, about black holes in particular. I hope there's still time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
No, this is not this. That's a slide I don't need.
So is this the last slide? Are you finished?
No, this is the last slide.
Okay. Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. I hope you answer a few questions. I cannot read these questions. I ask Dr. Mazemi to make the microphones open so that the questions can be asked by the person and we know who is asking the question. At the moment, I cannot see who is asking this question.
Can you hear me?
I can hear.
Okay, I have this question about the last slide. What happens to the ideas of manifolds and metric? Do you have to modify these ideas in order to be able to go on with these ideas?
Well, it is the same question as you as what was asked nearly a century ago about electromagnetism. There's photons, so when you have radiation, you have photons, but the photons are only there if you have a finite temperature. They are emitted by objects with a certain temperature, as Max Planck found. But then you can ask what happens when you put the temperature equal to zero. Then you have empty space and time. And at first sight, we say nothing happens in empty space-time. But in reality, we have what we call quantum fluctuations. So photons, electrons, in fact, all the other particles have very rapidly switch on and off in what we call the vacuum. So when we talk about the empty space and time, it's not empty at all. It has all these fluctuating particles. When it comes to photons and electrons, we understand how to put that into equations. It's a little bit difficult to make a picture, a drawing of fluctuating photons and electrons. Doesn't make much sense to try to draw, to fill the whole universe with photons and electrons. But yes, that is what the quantum equations say. So the only answer I can give to you is that the equations should give the answer. It's very hard to draw any pictures with the equations. In this particular case, I don't even have the equations. So I can only say in the slide before the first slide with the vacuole in there you see that that is a situation where I still can control the equations. I can write the equation of this. This vacuole is actually a four-dimensional vacuole. So it shows a black hole being formed and decaying again. So it's a little hole in the four-dimensional world of space and time. And there I can write down equations. But then filling the whole world, the whole universe, with these vacuoles is going to be impossibly difficult. We need some new mathematics to handle that, and it does not yet exist. So that's as far as I can get. That's why these last two few slides are really science fiction.
Okay. So one has to really redo Einstein's equations and the ideas of metric, manifold, etc., right?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
So again, I'm happy to answer questions. There are no stupid questions, by the way. They don't exist. So you won't be succeed in asking stupid questions.
Excuse me. I read a question. Do you hear me?
Yes, I hear you.
I'm reading a question from Dr. Pitaxi. How do you describe scattering from black holes? Is there any problem with unitarity?
That is part of the program. So when I said, I think I go to picture 29, can you show that? Can you show picture 29? 29. That one. Yes. So what you see here is the way I'm looking at black holes, which is that no, it does not connect two different universes. It connects the universe with itself in making a topologically non-trivial shape of space and time, because universe one and the other side of the black hole are connected in two ways. You can just simply walk around the black hole to great distance and go to the other side, or you can go through the black hole and go to the other side. So this makes space and time topologically non-trivial. But that doesn't stand in a way of writing down equations of how fields evolve. So you take a quantized field in this new space-time, and you can just ask, how does this quantized field propagate in space and time? And now you can write down the equations, and by itself, if you write down these equations, you still get a difficulty at the horizon. So the equations alone of just particles moving around here is not enough. You have to take into account something else. And what you have to take into account is that these particles interact gravitationally. If a particle tries to go through the horizon, it leaves behind what I call a gravitational footprint. So the particle goes in there, but it, by going in, it generates so much velocity that it moves, it shakes around about all the other particles. that shaking represents information of the incoming particle. In other words, the incoming particle does itself not emerge at the other side of the black hole because it's too late. Time, you see, time stands still at the horizon. So the incoming particle actually sits at the horizon doing nothing. That's not right. Quantum mechanically, something should come out. But what does come out of the black hole is a footprint of the incoming particle, the gravitational footprint. That contains all the information of the incoming particle. And now I can say that footprint also is a footprint in all the other particles where they are. So effectively, the incoming particle causes so much disturbance of the matter of the black hole that the black hole shakes out outgoing particles. This time, the outgoing particles carry the information of the incoming particle, so information is not lost. You can go through those equations, and it works extremely well. And one reason why the equations work so well is that you can expand energy and momentum going in into spherical waves. Actually, the spherical wave expansion is also what you apply when you solve the hydrogen atom. So soon after Schrödinger formulated his equation, he realized how to solve the hydrogen atom for this equation. But that goes by expanding all the waves in spherical waves. You do the same thing with the black hole, but now all matter is arranged in spherical waves. Spherical waves in causes spherical waves to go out at the same LM spherical quantum numbers. And that simplifies the equation so much that I can get a closed form for the actual scattering matrix of a black hole.
Thank you very much. I see one more question. I read it out. I cannot see who has sent it. The question is, could it be possible that a proton turn out to be a black hole?
Well, there would be, it's a very good question, by the way, so don't take me wrong, but it wouldn't quite work. And the reason is the proton is far too light. The proton is much lighter than 20 micrograms. So the Schwarzschild radius that such a black hole would have would be much, much smaller than 10 to the minus 33 centimeters. But at the distance scale of 10 to the minus 33 centimeters already, we don't know how space-time behaves. So when you try to look at even smaller structures in space-time, that makes no sense. So you can say that the black hole, that the proton is a black hole, but you can't do anything with that information because you need to understand the equations at the Schwarzschild radius of that black hole, but that's far too small. Even for the kind of physics I three, but 10 to the minus 50 or something, much, much smaller number than that, we don't have the equations for that. So yes, it's conceivable that the black hole is something, that the proton is something like a black hole, but no, we don't know how to use that information to say anything useful about the proton that you can't describe by using the standard model itself or try to add the gravitational force to the standard model. Then that's the best alley to try to understand the proton.
Thank you. The next question is not directly relevant to your talk. I will read it and you can choose to answer or not.
Sure.
Asks, what is your opinion about holographic principle and in particular ADS-CFT correspondence?
Okay, that is a well-informed question by, I presume, probably a physicist, because this is a very popular subject in string theory. Now, I did not mention string theory. Actually, I should have, because in string theory, people have very precise ideas about black holes. But they have ideas on how to make something that looks like a black hole in terms of strings. And then you can apply the ADS-CFT techniques to get answers that look like the answers which I want to have. In fact, they seem to be even more precise than what I can produce this way. But one doesn't answer the question literally, what happens when you see a horizon of a black hole? What happens when you go, when you enter a large black hole, and how do the equations hang together for large black holes? So to my taste, there are important questions that this approach does not answer. The one question that does answer is, what kind of equations should you write down for a black hole? And they say that's string theory. But I feel very uneasy about string theory at this level, because of the way of the kind of answers it gives, any kind of answers it does not give. And there are many answers it does not give. So I decided to use this alley instead of string theory to solve the question, answer the questions that I have. But ADS-TFT has turned out very useful for string theory. String theory has, however, not yet produced very much in physics that we couldn't derive better in some other way. So as I'm not too optimistic about the whole string theory approach. I'm not saying string theory is wrong. It is beautiful mathematics, but it replaces problems by other problems which I don't know how they should be answered.
Thank you very much. I don't have any more questions. I thank you again for accepting to give this talk in this conference. And we are all very grateful. Thanks a lot, Professor.
Thank you. I wish you much success with the remainder of the conference.
So thank you.
I hope it will work. Thank you again.